Okay. Wonderful. We're off and running. I appreciate every opportunity to be able to do a video. Who knows, what tomorrow will bring, whether I'll be able to do a video or not. And in fact, just doing this, I'm very shaken up because I've been working on these graphics that I've been mentioning, and I've been overwhelmed by it, and I can't sleep. My whole body's just shaking and trembling. So I wanted to assess the situation and see, should I just dump it all on the web just all at once? Is that the wise thing to do? And I said, hey, look, if I'm overwhelmed by this, I can't take it. I mean, just working on it was too much for me. And I'm still overwhelmed by it, overcome by it. Just, it's so sublime, I can't take it. It's people right now in the world, they spend an inordinate amount of time watching television, news, whatever, that's just pouring gruesome violence and psychotic violence into their mind constantly. It's just unbelievable how terrible the content is, and they seem to not be bothered by it at all. So we're used to hell. We're used to terrible stuff, right? But it's the sublime that we're not used to. This is a big problem, isn't it? Continuity problem. We are not used to the sublime. And so I spent my whole life trying to get used to the sublime, consciously doing this. I have, like I've said, massive collections of pictures of great spiritual teachers, which, were just have tremendous sublime impact. And I just subjected myself to them all, the most sublime content I can possibly find in my whole life. So I figured, oh, I'm immune to this. It's not going to bother me. But I was wrong. I mean, this just knocked me out. Very surprising. So there might be a few of you watching the video who would not be bothered by this at all. You're so far along that you just, oh, okay, it doesn't affect me at all. But if you're that so far so far along, then you don't need the pictures in the first place. So it's a moot point. For the rest of us, I would say what I've done is I'm going to release one picture a day on a Facebook page, on Twitter, and on Blogger, my blog site. And that way, it encourages people to go to those sites and start focusing on the content and what, something to look forward to every day. I know there's a blog that I used to go to every day, and I really look forward to it. I say there's something that I can do today to go to this blog and see what what's being said. I just it's a great habit to have, actually. So some people like Twitter, some like Facebook, some like blogs, and I'll put the also on these ta I'll put one picture on the video too, but that they're real small, low resolution. You get the full pictures like on Blogger. Twitter, they shrink it down a little bit. Facebook, I think you get, again, maybe shrink down a little bit, but you get a very large, large enough picture. I think it's 1024 by 512 is the actual size of these pictures I've been doing. And so that is what I decided to do for now. And to my generous nature is to just give everything to everybody right now, but in looking at these pictures, it's overwhelming. Just one is enough. Just one of them is overwhelming. If you really get into it and get the feel of it, and it's just wow, just wow. This is just awesome. It produces a tremendous reaction within me, at least. So to just go through hundreds of these at once, it's just that's just complete insanity. It's like just eating, chocolate bars one after the other, after the other, after the other. Like, one chocolate bar is enough, right? At a time, one chocolate bar is enough, and you can overdo it. So, or like drinking a, whatever. You get the idea. So, I decided to try this. And I will put the links again below this video in the description area. You might have to click for more, show more, and the window pops, the area pops down a little bit more, and then you can see the links there, and then you can go and bookmark the links, or remember, where they are, how to search for them, whatever, so you can get to them easily. And this way, you will gradually get used to what it is. The purpose of all of this doing is to get used to prepare to experience something that is beyond what we ordinarily expect. It is way better than what we expect. This is the whole purpose of all of this, is to prepare yourself to experience something way better than even your highest expectations. So wherever you're at, maybe you're super advanced, maybe, you know, not so advanced. Still, even if you're super advanced, what you should do is you should imagine a situation experiencing that is beyond, even better than what you're used to, to a significant extent, and then say, wow, I need to prepare for this. I need to prepare for this. So what we're doing is we're preparing for to experiencing which is very extraordinarily sublime. Way beyond what the ordinarily our normal expectations would be, especially way beyond what the expectations of the world are, which their expectations are so low, it's actually become an incredible embarrassment. You know, it's not even funny anymore. Well, you can look at it as funny, but it is an embarrassment. I mean, the expectations the world have. I mean, you talk about setting the bar low. That's present day culture. We set the bar so low. And if you can easily get caught up in this of setting the bar low and think, oh, everything's fine. See, I can jump over that bar. I can experience that. I can experience all the psychotic television shows, you know. Well, that's not the point. We need to set the bar high so we can experience what we're going towards is really eternal life. We are eternal life. Eternal life is the only life there is. Eternal life is the only life there is. And so we have no choice. We are eternal life, and we must experience this. We either pretend to be dead or we experience eternal life. However, there is a transitional phase where we go from pretending to be dead to experiencing eternal life, and we go towards pretending that we're experiencing eternal life. And there are pragmatic ways and means to help us do this, as what we're doing here, is that we practice full stop in the wow. That's the whole point of all these videos, is to practice full stop in the wow. Allow the sublime to impact you. Wherever you're at on the path, I mean, you know, you can always find something that is more sublime than what you're used to, and then practice full stop in the wow. And full stop in the wow is essentially saying, don't go into the judgmentalness at all. Don't go into that. Meaning, don't judge for the sublime or against it. Don't judge for it or against it, because we have a tendency when we're overwhelmed with the sublime to automatically shift into judging against it, no matter how we try to hide this from ourselves. We do. So the full stop in the wow means to simply suspend all judgment and just go into neutral mind, really. You're not thinking any thoughts. Now, I did this morning. I had such a hard time. I couldn't sleep. I woke up. I did a little sleep. I woke up and I realized my whole body is just vibrating, trembling. I'm just the sublimity was too much for me. I said, "Oh my gosh, how do I stop this?" Almost like a nervous breakdown, you know, not quite, but it's just too. I said, "What do I do?" Well, I made the essential shift, going from the glass half empty to a glass half full, and I embraced the wow of it. I said, this is just extreme wow. So the glass is half full, meaning I am going towards eternal life. I know I am. I know this is bringing me back to eternal life, back to accepting it. And then immediately I relaxed. I took a couple deep breaths, and I just felt my whole system just relax, because I had embraced the challenge, or embraced the wow, instead of saying, I don't know what this is, what's going on, how come I couldn't handle this? That's glass half empty. You say, oh my gosh, the glass is half empty. What do I do about this emptiness? What can I do about it? You get into a negative frame of mind. So go into the, hey, the glass is half full, and I'm really doing a great job in filling it up. You see, I'm doing a wonderful job. And I'm doing such a great job, I'm feeling this wowness. It's just very profound. So I need to full stop in the wow, and just don't try to judge for truth. Truth does not need to be judged for. It doesn't need us to judge for it. We already are eternal life. We don't need to judge eternal life is eternal life at all. It already is. So it's enough for us to not judge against it, to refrain from judging against eternal life. That is enough for us. And this is the discipline. So the way to do it, we just suspend judgment altogether. And that's, you can't lose then. You can't lose. See, this is the safe way that you cannot lose doing it this way. So, I did it, and I was able to get through. But still, when I went back to the images this afternoon just to do one more, oh boy, it hit me again. I said, "Wow, I can't really. This is really difficult to do. It's too much for me. It overwhelmed me." So let's give in a moment here. I'll shift over and show you a picture of the day, picture of the day. Jesus pick of the day. What they do is they depict Jesus as if it were, the theme is Jesus coming down from the mountains, coming up down from on high, and he's making a journey through these high mountains. We use the Himalayan mountains to depict this as the highest mountain range in the world. It's vast, you know, vast highest mountain range. He's coming down from on high, walking down through the Himalayan mountains, down towards us here in the world. Okay. This is like a depicting a journey. Jesus coming down from the mountain. Jesus coming down from the mountain. Now, I did make a video, but I'm not releasing at the moment. I got to think about what to do about it. It was too profound. It was too much for me. It's too much. It's just stunning. Just stunning. So I will ask for guidance on that. Anyway, so these pictures depict Jesus as if walking and stepping, taking a step down towards us, and he's going through these very sublime landscapes, very sublime landscapes. And if you get the drift of it, you know, it can be very impactful. And then what I do is I put some terms in there. What I did, I put some text on there, which put an even additional punch to it. Actually, I found an additional punch to it. So let us shift over to one of these the first graphic here. Jesus down from the mountain, and see if it works here. Aha, it worked, it worked, it worked, it worked, it worked, okay. So there's something about it's surreal, isn't it? Not only is the background surreal, but Jesus walking on the buildings, you know, he's larger than life, you see. He's bigger than life. And yet it all seems to be, in one way, just normal too, but another way, very surreal. It's very surreal, it's very sublime, and in this text I just put clarity, just clarity. You know, he's bringing clarity, you see, down from the mountain with clarity. And reality is clarity. Eternal life is the only life. There's only one will, that God's will is the only will there is. There is no second will. There is no substitute for it. There is no substitute for it whatsoever. It's absolute clarity. So this is a low resolution here, but it begins to give you an idea of what we're looking at here. And I put a lot of work into this, needless to say, and it had a tremendous effect on me, and it tested my nerve to the utmost. Potent, potent, potent stuff, which is what I wanted to get to. This is great. The potency is here. As you go through these pictures day by day and absorb the potency of them, this will be extremely helpful for you, for anyone, actually, except for those maybe who are so advanced that they don't even need to do it, in which case, that you know, they need to be doing what they need to be doing. I mean, just looking at this for me, it's just wow. I can feel it. For some reason, Nicholas Roerich, who's the painter, is for me the most impactful artist I've ever come across in a visual sense, visual artistry. I mean, he's just you can't even say genius. That would damn him with faint praise. There's something majestic and sublime about it. You know, his depictions, it stuns me. It really stuns me, beyond any other visual artist that I've ever come across. And he actually spent a tremendous amount of time in the Himalayas. He was there. He actually saw these landscapes and painted what he saw. But the way that he just depicts everything is just it's just wow. It's like you're in some sort of sublime setting. And to see Jesus just walking down through this, just easily walking through this air, landscapes like this, step by step by step down towards us. Now, in doing these graphics, I needed to come up with captions, or not captions. This is actual. I'm just a text added, and so for inspiration for some of them, I went to A Course in Miracles, and I just leafed through the whole book, just going through here, all the pages, different lessons, and just kind of see what struck my eye as something to put in that really captured what I was feeling, and in doing so, I became just stunned by the brilliance of A Course in Miracles and the mind that made this available, that put this to, really made it available. I mean, we know that Helen Schuckman did shorthand through the impressions she received, and William Thetford helped her transcribe this. But we're talking about the real author of all this, the mind that easily conceived all this and put it all together and brought help, gave it to us. I mean, just. It beggars description. I could not, I cannot. It's just a clarity that is beyond words entirely. It's just astonishing clarity. Now, it was quite gratifying to see that I was able to really understand, and much of what's being said there is what's internalized in my own clarity. So that was very gratifying. But it's one thing to be able to do that, but it's another thing entirely to be able to produce this entire book with just all of that, just right there, with this extraordinary cohesiveness. I mean, that is just truly astonishing, and it comes from Jesus. So Jesus is truly an astonishing teacher. By any angle you view Jesus, he's an astonishing teacher. And it's a great challenge. It's a great challenge to meet up with this clarity. And you realize, oh my gosh, I'm just a little elephant, I'm just a little elephant here. Yeah, I may be an elephant. Elephant mind means, very bright, strong mind, but I'm just a little elephant. I mean, Jesus is this massive, massive elephant. I'm just a little baby elephant. So, and it's very humbling, which is great, which is really, really great. If you want to be truly humbled spiritually, just leaf through A Course in Miracles and just bounce around for an hour or two. And you can come away just say, oh my gosh, how can anyone be so spiritually clear? And adamant and brilliantly understanding our situation. I mean, just he knows our troubles to such an extent that I can't explain it. How in the world is anyone such a great therapist to understand our mind in the way that he understands it? That I can't explain, because I'll have to see that in hindsight. I mean, exactly. I don't know. Did he go through all of it himself, and experience every bit of it, or what? You wonder. Maybe he did. Maybe he did have that kind of brilliance. Now, sometimes I put music to this, and which makes it even more overwhelming. I don't know. I put music to the video I listened to, and it just knocked me out. I it made it very emotional, and maybe that's too much. Maybe it's better to just watch it without. But if you want to put music to it, you have to watch your own wow reaction. But that is one option. You whatever can help you. I mean, there's just a ton of different musical expressions out there that one could listen to, right? But music, you gotta be very careful with music. Very, very careful indeed. It's a slippery slope. I often find silence is best, just because you can be very much in touch with the wow and aware of it. Yeah, so for some reason, these overwhelm me. I don't know why, but it just hits me so hard. I don't know how to explain it. But anyway, so I'm rolling it out. I'm doing, you know, what I, every day I try to go bigger and top the previous day. And so I'm engaged in rolling out preparation for Jesus to return. Now people might say, well, you know, what? Jesus returning? Well, here's an example. Let's say you don't follow politics at all, which I really don't. There's a lot of times in my life I paid no attention to politics whatsoever. I had no idea what's going on. No idea. So let's say you're one of those people. Congratulations, that's very good. You wouldn't have any idea what's going on in politics right now. For instance, in the United States, you might be in other countries. There are viewers from all over the world. But we use the United States. That's where I am, for example. You wouldn't have any idea that, for instance, Donald Trump was running for president. Okay, you have no idea. Now, let's say someday you happen to turn on television and you're looking at all this stuff and you say, what? What the heck is going on? Donald Trump? I mean, are you kidding? What? You might even know who Donald Trump is. Who is this guy? You know, just like, wow. I don't know. Okay, fine. So you don't follow politics, you wouldn't know that Donald Trump is running for president. You wouldn't know it at all. Now, let's say you don't follow the return of Jesus. You don't follow that at all, right? And most people don't, do they? So you wouldn't have any idea if Jesus had returned or not, would you? You wouldn't have any idea whatsoever. And if somebody told you, hey, Jesus has returned, you'd say, what? You know, I had no idea Jesus returned. I just wasn't following it at all. So now, let's flip the script a little bit. And let's say you do follow politics, right, very closely. Well, you would know that Donald Trump was running for president, and you would know what he's been saying, what he's doing, and he's leading, you know, the Republicans and all this kind of thing. You'd say, wow, but, you know, I'm aware of it. I'm very keenly aware of it. And if someone asked you what's going on with politics, you say, well, you know, there's this situation with Trump, and he's you know, sucking all the air out of the room and dominating the publicity. It's really, and then people say, wow, that's pretty surprising, huh? Okay, now let's say, so you would know about it. Let's say you're somebody that follows the return of Jesus very closely, very, very closely. And let's say Jesus did return. Okay, let's just use this. Say Jesus did return, and you would be aware of it, right? If you really follow closely, you know, you should be aware of that if you follow closely. And so you might tell someone else, oh yeah, they might ask you, and say, oh yeah, Jesus has returned. They say, what, really? I haven't been following that at all. That's really a big surprise. It's like that. I mean, I guess people think that even though they don't follow at all, Jesus' return, they have not followed at all, are just mere dilettantes or whatever, that somehow they would know about it. You know, if it had happened, oh, of course I wouldn't know about that. Really? I mean, that's like somebody who doesn't follow politics at all, and they think, well, I should know everything that's going on in politics. Come on, of course not. Of course not. You wouldn't know. You would not know unless you follow. And especially with the Jesus situation, You have to be extraordinarily tuned into it, because we have this amnesia about this, that it's so overwhelming to us that we tend to block it out. Okay, block it out. Say, that's just too much for me to deal with. So even if you follow very closely, there's a lot of people who are saying Jesus is about to return. We know it. Okay, a lot of people are saying that. And I said that too. I said, I know. I can tell the signs. The signs are there. He is preparing. He has prepared us. A Course in Miracles was in preparation for his return. Even though when people asked him, well, are, you know, those who supposedly were able to be in touch with him in some way, they asked him, are you coming back? Do you have plans to come back? He says, well, I don't have any plans at this time. Yeah, that was his answer. Meaning he's saying, look, I'm completely free. I don't plan like that. He didn't say he wasn't coming back. You know, he didn't actually say that. He said, well, the return of Christ is really the rebirth of Christ awareness in all of us. But this is a very metaphysical answer. It didn't say he didn't say, well, I am not coming back at all. He never said that. He never said he wasn't coming back. So he's very coy about this. He dodged the question. He said, I don't have any plans at the moment. I don't have any plans at the moment. That's a dodge, isn't it? So, you know, I knew he was coming back. And I said, okay, just look, keep looking, keep looking, keep preparing, keep preparing, keep preparing. And then I experienced this dream in which he came down from on high. like from a huge mountain range from on high, and walked down and said, "I'm back. Okay, I'm back, and I'm here." And so I experienced it very, very powerfully that he's back, May 1st, 2015. Around that time, it could have been the 31st of April, you know, the 30th, 31st, May 1st. It's right in this area. Okay, I'm just going to use May 1st, but it's right in this area, time frame. And he, you know, so I know he's back. I know he's back. But unless you follow it very carefully and are willing to allow it into, to accept it, then you would say, well, I know it's very near, but I don't think it's happened yet. Okay, that's what you would say. So there's a lot of people who know it's very near. Okay, any day. Okay, I just differ a little bit, and for me, I'm saying he's already returned. It's already happened. So what I have done is I'm working to roll out this information to people. And so far, you know, no response. Because it's something people block out. Why? They're not prepared. They're not prepared for it. So if you're not prepared for something, the mind is quite extraordinary. It is able to dissociate and block stuff out. If something's overwhelming, it just disassociates from it and says it doesn't exist. Hasn't happened. So they will say, okay, I understand that it's near, but it hasn't happened yet. But this is typical. You know, you push it forward, kick the can down the road. But for me, no. I say it's already happened. I know he's already here. I really better shift into even higher gear now, and really go big every day. But so I recommend to everyone who's preparing for this to go big every day. Go big to go home. If you want to go home, you have to go big. And that is, continue to, you know, let go of this dissociation, so you become aware, like, the opportunity that is here. You become aware of it, and then meet the challenge. We have a challenge. We have a great opportunity, which is a challenge. Now, what is that great opportunity? Well, Jesus is going to do something, all right? I mean, he's shown that he goes big. I mean, A Course in Miracles was going big. Really, really, really big. Okay, so was Journey Beyond Words and The Other Voice, by, you know, so he went super big. Okay, coming back is going super big, isn't it? Returning to this world, his attention is fully on this world now. And okay, so he has a pattern, and showing up 2,000 years ago, what he did there, he went really big, apparently, because it shocked the world for the last 2,000 years. He went huge. So he has a definite pattern of going really big, okay? There's no way around this issue unless you just want to dissociate it, all right? So you got to expect that he's going to go really big. You have to expect it. Jesus doesn't go small. He goes big, really big. Because what he tells us is, what he is attracting us to is eternal life, plain and simple. That's it. Eternal life. That's the only life. Eternal life is the only life there is. And that's big. That's really big. It doesn't get any bigger than that. So that's what he's all about. He's the spokesperson for eternal life. And he attracts us to that. And he doesn't fool around. He goes really big. So knowing that he's already back, I said, oh my gosh, you know what? I've got to really work at it. So I've been working at it. And trying to go even bigger each and every day. And this helps roll out the situation. It helps it roll out. Now, you may say, well, it's just starting a little tiny thing here. Yeah, well, you know, something big starts, a little snowball, you know, can keep rolling it. Gradually, it picks up more and more, and then it becomes, you know, exponential, right? And then the weight of that snowball gets so strong, it may start pushing a whole bunch of other snow. And that snow pushes more, and before you have this avalanche. Well, we don't want to use a negative turn, like an avalanche. You think, oh, it's terrible, but you get the idea that you know, you can get this momentum can become exponential at some point, actually. So start out slowly. I mean, Jesus, when he was here before, he just called a couple of apostles, you know, here and there, you know, and a few followed him here, a few followed there, and it would start out very slow and gradual, then it grand momentum began picking up. So first are the ones that can handle the situation, won't dissociate it, go into dissociation. They say, wow, they say, hey, it's real, it's here, I gotta go big. And they take up the challenge of going big. Obviously, those are the ones who are going to go first. I had a dream last night, which was quite stressful. Two people, Somebody from was going to come up from up north in California or something and come to see me, and they expected me to be part of a band. You know, I was supposed to be playing lead guitar or something. I said, "Well," and they said, "You're going to take the first, you know, lead. You're going to take the first lead break." And I said, "What?" I said, "I haven't played lead guitar in almost 20 years. You know, really." I haven't played guitar. I stopped playing. It's been basically 20 years. I said, "Well, I can't. You just can't, you know, do that." I guess I could fake it, you know, if you get like a low enough action electric guitar with your good amplifier and a bunch of effects, you know, I could fake something, for sure. I get a Kramer, you know, with like an ultra fast action neck, and it's just so easy to hit the frets, you know, easy to fret the notes. It's like, okay. But I was really stressed out. I mean, something, I'm being asked to do something, and there's somebody who's coming, some kind of expert or something. I said, "What? So what are you talking about? I'm supposed to take the lead? Are you kidding me? I mean, it's crazy. I mean, it's like some, let's take some like virtuoso who's going to play and say, I'm supposed to join their band with this virtuoso. I'm supposed to play the first lead. I said, are you kidding me? That's ridiculous. But I was thinking about it today, and I realized that I could fake it. You know, I could probably fit. No melodies come to mind. I mean, there's nothing that comes to my mind as far as playing. I'm so far out of playing that nothing even comes to mind at all. But, you know, it's like riding a bicycle. You know, I could fake it. Which is what a lot of really good guitar players are anyway. They're just expert fakers. There's very few virtuosos out there. I mean, there are some, but a lot of the ones that sound really, really great and good, they're just really good fakers. So Eddie Van Halen said, he hit all these tricks and could fake a lot of stuff, and, you know, just is very, very good at it. So, yeah, I don't know, but this could be a metaphor for something. But I said, holy cow, you expect me to play in this band? Are you kidding me? I'm just a dilettante, you know. Totally out of shape. So I don't know, something's coming, it's making me very nervous, you know, as far as expectations. But I said, well, you know, yeah, I would do it. I would do it. It's okay. You know, I can hold my own, I guess, as far as just, doesn't matter how well I do, really, you know, as long as it's just showing up, I guess, is, you know, pretty much what's really important. So there, it seems to be that there is some sort of pressure on me to get up to speed. So that's great. So there's something, you know, rolling out. There's something that's rolling out. Jesus is rolling something out. There's no question about it. And you don't want to miss the opportunity. You want to connect with the sublime. You want to connect with the sublime. Again, no matter how advanced anyone may be in the world, you still want to connect with something that's even more sublime than what you're used to, right? Even if you're used to the tremendous sublimity, you still want to have even more, you would think, right? You would think. And if that's not, if you reach the ultimate and that's enough, then you would know that everybody else wants to get there too, and you know that you must gradually get used to. It's so sublime. We're so into pretending that we're dead that you just don't pull yourself up by the bootstraps. It doesn't work that way. You need to practice. You need to practice, plain and simple. It's like somebody who's never played electric guitar before. You throw them on stage, you know, with a bunch of like expert musicians, and says, "Here, take the lead." You know, what would that? That would be cruel, wouldn't it? Be absolutely cruel to do that to somebody. And they, what the heck is this? Strap the guitar on, and you know, they got stacks of amps there, and they, you know, hit something, and you know, it's like everyone goes, "Oh my God!" And they, you know, they just make noise. It may be horrible. It would just mortify them. I experienced a situation where we were asked to do some benefit concert in high school, and I didn't want to because we were terrible. We were just a jam band. We were not a dance band. We were a jam band. We were, you know, experimental jam band. That's what we were. We enjoyed it. It was fantastic. But playing for playing customers, forget it. We were like a dance band knows how to play songs. We didn't play any songs, so we were terrible. We were absolutely terrible. We just played super loud, hoping to, you know, the vines would say, "Wow, look how loud they are." But it was a disaster, and I never, you know, I was mortified, absolutely mortified. I got talked into it by someone I should have not got talked into it, you know, by. It was really just to make them look good, you know. But and so I felt persona non grata after that in school because I just embarrassed myself. And I mean, we were a jam band, totally different thing, garage jam band. Man, we could play some great jams, but also we could go into some lousy stuff. That's what jamming is about: is you're pushing your boundaries. You might hit some very sublime stuff, and then you might just be like completely out of sync for a while, and then you might find a new groove, and get into that, and it might sound great for a while. Now, everybody had the freedom to do whatever they wanted to do. So I know what being mortified like on stage is like. I know what it's like. I really had just the absolute pits of experiencing that. And it caused me severe problems because I was so ashamed, you know, by that, because the people, nobody said, "What in the heck is this? We came out here to watch this and paid money and all this kind of stuff. What in the heck is this?" It was just complete disaster. Never went on stage again. Never went on stage again. That was it. That was the end. Forget it. Actually, one time I was at a party, a very ritzy place, just a private, people were just having a private wine tasting party, so I went on stage and played a little bit, and it was okay, but even that wasn't so great, yeah, but it wasn't bad, but very minimal, so, you know, you don't just throw someone on stage who cannot handle it. You cannot do that. So the idea that somehow everyone can just be enlightened, you know, just like that, is ridiculous. They have no idea what it's about. They, as Jesus points out in A Course in Miracles, we have so many defenses. We have, the ego is so crafty and clever, and fear is so extreme. We have the tremendous continuity problem. You can't do that to somebody. So, you know, in order to get on stage, you really have to have techniques to keep yourself grounded, and so full stop on the wow. Glass is half full. Full stop on the wow. I don't need to judge for truth at all, and I make sure I don't judge against it. You have to have these techniques, and you have to be very good at them. You have to be very, very practiced in these in order to handle the kind of pressure if you're like thrown on stage, some sort of stage, you know. Because you're not going to be that good. I mean, you got stuff coming at you from every angle. And the situation is like overwhelming. So you just have to be able to center yourself in full stop in the wow, where you don't think anything. That's it. You don't judge for the situation at all. You don't judge against it at all. Whatever's happening, you're no longer you're detached from it because you're full stop in the wow. You're not judging for or against it. So if you're going to play, you know, a significant role in the rollout of Jesus' return to this world and what is going to happen as we go along in this world, then I think it's pretty safe to say that some sort of tribulation will happen here. It's certainly following the script to a T. What we expect. So if you're going to play a role like that, you have to be very good at centering yourself and calming yourself down no matter what happens, good or bad, whatever, it doesn't matter. You don't judge it. You must be able to suspend judgment and go into this non-judgmental condition where you're not thinking anything. You cannot do it by a bunch of erudition, like, you know, you cannot do it. Like, let me read A Course in Miracles and become really, really, fill my mind with all these thoughts and sentences of how smart I am, spiritually smart. That doesn't work. It doesn't work. You have to be able to drop all of that and just go into neutral state, full stop in the wow. When nothing is being judged, neither for nor against anything whatsoever. Now, when Jesus returned in that dream, he said, "Anyone want to relate with me? I have come back to relate in friendship with all of you. Anyone like to do that?" And I raised my hand. Nobody else would raise their hand. And I'm looking back, saying, maybe I made a mistake. Maybe I should have been a full stop of the wow at that time. You know, maybe Maybe that's the answer, but maybe not. You know, maybe I had practice full stop on the well enough to say, you know, I think I can hang with you, Jesus, because I have this practice you've given me, and I can employ this practice. Because if you're hanging with something very sublime, you're going to have to do this practice. You're going to have to be able to calm yourself down, suspend judgment. You're going to have to be able to do it. And you can't just ride the enthusiasm if you're all hyped up by taking coffee and energy drinks, because then you're going to crash into severe depression eventually. You have a nervous breakdown. Do not want that to happen at all. So, you know, with being thrown on stage, well, I try not to think about it, you know. But I was driving today, I said, what in the world would I do if somebody put me on stage with electric guitar and said, you take take the lead here. Well, I'd look good. I would look good doing it, for one thing. I could play air guitar. You know, I could air guitar. It's like riding a bicycle. I know, you know, I know how to at least act like I'm playing. I could act like it. I could, you know, like, oh, the guy knows what he's doing. You know, obviously, he's, you know, but I'd only, and I was thinking, like, maybe I should do like the Shadows did, you know, the guy they played for the Shadows, you know, the Cliff Richards backup band. I can't remember it. Can't remember his name, but the guy hit like one note at a time, you know. Dun, 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 dun. You know, and you play that way. You could play that way. Just hit one note and sustain it, you know. And I'd probably do something like that to start out with, because I can't remember how to play all this fancy lickety split stuff anymore. You know, that's like another lifetime, several lifetimes ago, actually. But yeah. Yeah, like Apache, you know, by da 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 da, boom da da da, you know, that kind of real simplistic sort of lead, and just have a great tone, you know, just go for the tone. Yeah, sounds great, sounds fine. There's nothing wrong with that. You don't have to play fancy fast, you know. Throw in some tapping there if you want to, to make it seem like you know what you're doing. Some Van Halen tapping, whatever. But yeah, I mean, I guess I could fake it. And then as you do get fake it, you get a little better and a little better and a little better. But I don't think it has to do with playing guitar. You know, I think this dream had something to do with else, but I don't know. Who knows? But you get the idea. You get thrown up in a situation where people are really expecting a lot from you. You know, you cannot be just, you know, completely ignorant, and because you're just going to be mortified that you just, you know, what am I doing here? I shouldn't be here. I mean, this is just, people are getting ripped off. I mean, they're not getting what they expect. I mean, what in the world, you know? Nobody wants to be put in that kind of situation. So I was kind of nervous. I said, that dream. I said, what? Are you kidding me? You want me to do what? Really? I said, I'm just a dilettante. I mean, come on. I mean, you really? But again, just taking the stage and just being able to, I mean, I could handle being on the stage with anybody. Yeah, you know, it wouldn't bother me, I don't think. I could still, you know, hold the guitar and have it on and, you know, hit some chords. Sure, why not? It'd be okay. Funny stuff. The path is very interesting, isn't it? What happens is very interesting. You never know what's coming around the corner, it seems like. And you get hecklers, you know, you get people who don't like you. They're trying to make themselves feel good, I guess, by heckling you or yelling, you know. You get all different types. And there's a lot of people who are really in, you know, very stuck here. I mean, we're all very stuck. Let's, you know, be honest. We're all very stuck. Some are not quite as stuck as others through a tremendous amount of work, but we're all still stuck. I mean, we're not experiencing eternal life really as it is, as it truly is. We're not. And as long as we're here in this world, we won't experience it. We can most we can really experience is pretending to be eternal life here. So, you know, that's okay. That's the goal. And see, the thing is, for instance, like, you know, I know I wouldn't play well, but I know, like, for instance, if I really got into it and played every day and I really focused in on it, I'd be able to play fine. I'd be able to play fine. Wouldn't be a problem for me, actually. Theoretically, you know, unless my wrist and, you know, but that, I can, you have to make that better with the mind. But yeah, I mean, you get up to speed. Get up to speed. It's like you haven't ridden a bike in like 20 years. You know, you can pedal it around to the store, but you know, you can't take it on some ride up through the mountains very well, easily, right? But you can get back up to speed to, doing that. So when I was really practicing a lot, I could hang with anybody. I wasn't as good as these. There's some, you know, people who dance bands. I mean, they knew how to, you know, be commercially sound, have this commercial sound and sound good. And just as a young person, I wanted to be experimental, so I wasn't into that. But as far as, you know, being able to play anything, I could hang with just about anybody. You know, couldn't play as clean or as precise. Or there's some real, there were a few virtuosos around at the time, like Robin Ford. At the time, we all said, "Wow, this guy is really a virtue, you know, really a virtuoso kind of." And he went on to have a, you know, still playing a long, long career. But he was just playing up here in Ukiah, California. I mean, Robin Ford, Chris Ford Band, or Robin Ford Band, whatever, they, you know, with the harmonica and stuff. And I mean, they were just kicking it. But I mean, they're just like sort of like a, you know. They grew up in a musical family, blues band. I mean, they were just, you listen to that, they were just some young kids, you know, playing. It was just like, wow, these guys are really good. And so there, you know, there's some people are, you know, just happen to be super talented at certain things, you know, that's okay. You know, if you're not super talented, that's okay, that's fine. So, you know, can I talk about certain spiritual topics? Sure, you know, I may not be like some virtuoso, so that's okay. The virtuosos understand. Jesus understands that we're not up to speed like he is, okay? Of course he understands that. It's obvious, so it is okay. You know, once we learn the lessons perfectly, you know, we will be up to speed, and that will happen, maybe. Faster than we know. The heat is starting to come now. Tomorrow's supposed to be really hot. Next day, really hot. And you can tell this evening, the dusk is really still. Beautiful, beautiful summer evening here right now. Blue skies up there, the yellow skies on the horizon. It's just awesome. Another awesome California day. Too much awesomeness on the weather here, really. I mean, this must be getting us ready for paradise. Over the last 4 years, the weather here has just been indescribably, even for California, it's been indescribably awesome. It would feel spoiled, really. Just like, wow, another incredible day? Oh my gosh, what's going on here? It's amazing. You know, we say, yeah, it's a drought, terrible drought. Yeah, but you know, maybe this is getting us ready for something. Keep in mind, look at it in the bigger picture. And maybe everything that's happening in the world is the apocalypse is getting us ready for something. That's how I feel. Absolutely. So I embrace it. I embrace the wow of it. I'm not worried about what's going on in the world so much. For me, look at it half, glass is half full. It's all good. This is preparing us for something really sublime. This is how I look at it. And if you're able to look at that, you will find yourself, it's like night and day, you will find yourself in the light instead of in the darkness. You won't be so fearful. Because if you don't do it that way, you say, I don't know what this is for. Oh my gosh, it could be terrible. What's going on? I'm not really sure. And you're just like thinking, what? But if you say, no, I know this is all preparing me for something much, much better. So I'm just going to relish the opportunity to get used to it, to get used to it, to get used to it, and look at it very positively. And then this will just, it'll like flip your script so much that you just say, oh, I'm living in the light. You know, this is great. Even though we're in this horrendous drought in California, I say this is wonderful because the weather is just like off the charts, beautiful. So much so that you wonder really, what world am I living in? I mean, was it yesterday, day before, the weather was so wonderful. I look at everything, drive down the street, I say, is this a dream? Is this some kind of dream world I'm in right now? I mean, just all the trees and the foliage, the light and everything the way it was is just like, I said, what is this? So I just said, this is great. Let me just relish this. Let me take it in. Let me embrace it. Let me embrace this. This is the way, look at the world. The world is half full. The glass is half full. Everything that's happening is for your best, highest good. It's leading you toward that which is more sublime. And in the case of these graphics, this has been true. This has been true. I mean, it's proven to me. This proved it to me that, you know, everything I've been experiencing in as far as working with graphics has led me to, for me, these are the most sublime graphics I've ever experienced in my life. Really. And so, you know, it just shows, you keep going, keep saying the glass is half full. I'm being prepared for something more sublime. I'm ultimately being prepared for the real world, for the death-free realm, for paradise, to see just beauty beyond anything we can describe. It is so sublime we cannot even have, don't even have words for it. I am being prepared for that. Step by step by step, gradually being prepared for that. And when you look at it that way, you will find you keep coming across more and more sublimity. And just when you think you couldn't possibly go any further, you know, you go further. So I was having all these, I was doing these graphics. I started out by doing these posters of Jesus. I actually started out just doing some overlay graphics in a Photoshop-like program, and that was really sublime. And eventually, then I did these posters, and this is stretched a little bit, but I did these posters, and I felt, wow, that was really sublime. And then doing these text on the artwork, directly on it, and that was more sublime. I didn't see it coming. I said, oh my gosh, how do I top this? How do I top this? And so I don't know how to top these graphics at all. I really, I'm not sure how to do it. I have some vague idea of something else I can do. But so it shows you there is a progression. There is a progression. Like in music, for instance, if you've been through a musical progression in your life, you know, you start out. And the better you get, the more attuned you are to like better and better music, and so you will come across great, better and better and better and better stuff. And whereas other people may not even be aware of it, you're listening to this, and they're listening to that, and you realize, oh, yeah, I used to listen to that, quite some time ago, and I thought it was great when I was listening to it, but now I'm listening to something I realize is much, much better. So you do go through a progression towards the sublime. We're all going through a progression towards the sublime. But the sublime is way better than we expect or can imagine, actually. It's quite extraordinary. It ultimately, we experience a situation that's completely free of any trace of death, sickness, accident, you know, where it reflects eternal life. We actually experienced that. I've had one experience of that already, and it freaked me out. After a little while, it freaked me out. I just couldn't take it. It was overwhelming. So I've been preparing for that, realizing, wow, if I want this, I have to prepare for it because it overwhelmed me. I just said, this is too much awesome for me. You got to be a trooper. You got to be a trooper and actually, you know, get out there, do it. Actually, do it. Keep, Keep being exposed to the sublime. Now, I didn't say the slime. Television and movies and most of the internet and most of books and magazines and basically any content that you come across is slime. Okay, it's not sublime, it's slime. When you do that, you're preparing yourself for stuff that's even more slimy. And then, of course, if you look at culture, that's exactly what has happened. As pharmaceutical culture has gained the upper hand in the world, of course they want you to feel a need. They want to create a need for their products, right? I mean, what business, like car dealerships, do you think that they want to train people to like bilocate or don't need cars at all? I mean, no, they want you to learn how to drive. You think they want people not know how to drive? No, they want everybody to know how to drive, to want to drive, to need to drive, so they buy their cars. This is how business works. Business tries to create as much demand for their product as possible, and they use any and all means they can come up with to do so. And the pharmaceutical companies are no exception to this whatsoever. None whatsoever. So they want to create as strong a market for their products as possible. And so what they would do, what they're doing is they're helping the world become more and more messed up. You know, sick. The world is so much sicker than it used to be. It's just you can't even describe it. Like I said, the content that we have now, none of it would have been allowed 50 years ago. Almost none of it. People would have been absolutely horrified and shocked, and said, "What? This is completely demonic. You cannot put that out here. We have limits to So." We have gone so far down into sickness that we don't realize how far we've gone down. But if you were alive, you know, you have some age, you're able to compare the 1950s, and in the 60s, and then my parents, my grandparents go all the way back to the 19th century. I can, they tell me how it was back then. And, I know, I have a feel for it. And so I know that we're way sicker than we used to be. So much so, it's just, you can't even hardly measure it. Don't even bother measuring it so much, such an extreme. This is designed so that we will need the products of the pharmaceutical, the medical industry, essentially, the health, wellness, medical, pharmaceutical, this biggest industry in the world. Nothing comes even close to it. And they want to create a need for it. They've done everything. They've been very, very busy. They've spent their money wisely, smartly, cleverly. And so we put our attention on that content. We're getting slimed. We're getting very slimed. And, of course, the Antichrist teaching is that only when we destroy ourselves will we then be resurrected back into authenticity without guilt, you see. And this is the Antichrist teaching, the path. And this is what most people are on, that path. Or they're trying to outsmart themselves and think, well, I'll be on both paths. I'll go both ways. And whichever way turns out to work, then that'll be work for me. And Jesus says you can't serve two masters. It doesn't work that way. You only will become very stuck, very confused, very eccentric, very stuck, very, very stuck in some sort of eccentricity, whatever. There's infinite varieties, actually. Infinite varieties. So you have to go the right direction. You have to go the right way, which is to recognize that we don't need to do anything. There never was any guilt to get rid of. We don't need to pretend to be dead. We don't need to kill ourselves before we can be resurrected to our authenticity. We don't have to. Our authenticity doesn't have to die in order to be authentic. The idea we have to destroy ourselves to be authentic is of course ridiculous, completely whimsical. And Jesus tells us this. He tells us the right way. There's only one direction, one way to go to happiness, not two ways. There's only one will, not two wills. There's nothing to choose between. There's not God's will and some other will. There's no choice to make at all. So we don't need judgment, do we? Judgment inherently implies a duality, doesn't it? But we understand the continuity problem. We do make at least one choice, which is the final judgment. Such a final judgment is I don't need judgment. And making that judgment, we can pretend to be eternal life, keep pretending for a while because we think that's our functioning. We're so used to doing it, we think if we weren't pretending, we would be nothing. So this is a big concern in our mind, deep within us, our minds. So there's something big coming. There's no question. I'm really, you know, frantically preparing for something. Interesting. In the dream, I felt like someone was coming from like Antioch or something. In the Bay Area, there's a place called Antioch, I believe. Now, wasn't Antioch one of like the original places of Christianity in Asia Minor, which I think is Turkey? I mean, I think it was Antioch, wasn't it? Interesting. So that's a tie-in with early Christianity, isn't it? And Jesus, apostolic Christianity, is Antioch. So there's someone who's very, very, and also the person. I was aware that someone asked me, what do they do? Why are they so important? I said, well, they built this freeway, I-15, Interstate 15. They actually designed and built the whole thing. I mean, built an entire freeway. You know, and I said, that's extraordinary. I mean, this is someone who's very extraordinary. Okay, what's a freeway? Well, the way to freedom, isn't it? As a play on words, the freeway, the way towards freedom. So this is some Antioch builder of a freeway. 15, year 2015, you know, it's a pretty significant dream, and I'm supposed to, you know, front for them, you know, it's like, hey, front, are you kidding me, front for, you know, that's like fronting for George Jones or something, get up in the stage, you're supposed to sing, you know, fronting for George Jones, even. Well, you know, last week I could have done that, at least for a couple, 30 minutes, but, you know, now I can't do it, because it was just kind of a peak sort of experience. I mean, it's potentially it's doable. People might say, okay, it's not Jones, but it's okay. So you know, we're not going to like boom off the stage or something. But even if they're booing, you just keep doing the best you can. That's all. Don't worry about it. I would think. I don't know. But you just can't afford to be mortified. But anyway, you'd have to underplay the whole thing in the first place anyway. I mean, the rollout you have to underplay it. It's like in church, you undersing it. You underplay the whole thing. You don't just belt out the music. You keep it subdued, soft, subdued, you know. You're not there. This is not a concert. So you underplay it. So, you know, you know maybe that's the thing to do, is just underplay the whole situation to start out with. You know, and then, you know, it picks up steam as you go along. But, yeah, there's definitely this big nervousness now. I feel like something huge is coming. There's no question about it. Now, let's say Jesus shows up. What would I do? Well, you just full stop in the wow and just don't judge for or against it. And just say, well, I'm not really having any opinion at all on it. Just no thoughts at all about it. Just of course, it's a wow. And then you just say, I'm not judging for it or against it. Not thinking any plans one way or the other. No plans, no judgment, no strategizing, no reactions. Just the wow. That's it. You know, just have to keep practicing that a lot, no question about it. But it's a refuge, isn't it? It's taking refuge in the wow. Take refuge in the wow. Take refuge in the wow. Now, audience members, the same thing. You know, whatever your experience, that's sublime. You know, you have to take refuge in the wow at some point. Otherwise, you're not letting it in. You got to let the sublime in. You know, there are those who do fool themselves and say, well, I don't have any reaction. Well, they didn't let it in. That's why. When you let the sublime in, you're going to have a wow reaction for sure. And you have to manage that. So don't say anything. You know, just be quiet. Permission to be quiet is very important.